So this afternoon we have the pleasure of presenting to you today the exhibition that Jeffrey Kipnis and Matt Ford did on Peter Eisenman for the 15th Architecture Biennale in Venice. And we're going to start off. First of all, I'd like to introduce the people to you. That's Matt Ford, a Knowlton School graduate in 2002, went on and got his graduate degree at Yale, now teaches at the New York Institute, NYIT, New York Institute of Technology in New York. Jeffrey Kipnis, a Georgia State graduate, I believe, and a professor in the school. Peter Eisenman, a Cornell, Columbia, and Cambridge University graduate. So, without further ado, Matt is going to walk you through the exhibition, and then Jeff and Peter and Matt will have a discussion about the exhibition. Matt.
So, flipping through, we're going to talk about an exhibition that's currently on view in Venice at the moment that with the help of Peter and Jeff, we curated. So we're going to talk through two things. I'm going to give you a quick introduction to the curatorial assertion, what we were trying to do with the exhibition. We're going to go through Eisenman's struggle with the humanist tradition very briefly. And then in 9.5 minutes, we're going to cover 50 years worth of work very quickly. So, wake up your eyes, you're going to see a lot. First thing, this exhibition came about where we were just given free rein to dig around the warehouse in Brooklyn, the office, Peter's house. And anytime you can get a slide with a cat in it is probably a good thing to show. So we dug through all of this material and found what we could. And we put it together in an exhibition that looks like this in the Palazzo Bembo in Venice. We should stop on this one. So the curatorial assertion that we're talking about, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the main focus of the Venice Biennale that's currently going. Ours was discussing a project of activism that we found through Eisenman's work, but not one in the traditional means. But our assertion was that he has an activist project by other means. That's the title of the exhibition in the book. And really that any project, any architectural project that challenges the traditional relationship between the discipline and instantiated power can be considered a project of activism. So we trace this through Eisenman's relationship with humanism. And as you'll see on the slides, we see some work that I don't think any of you have ever seen before from Peter's undergraduate education. We're going to start with that. We're going to work our way through to the more famous houses and wrap up in Berlin 50 years later. So I guess I should flip through to some of these. So this slide is the program for his undergraduate thesis. Believe it or not, he was an undergraduate at one point in time, too. This was 1955 at Cornell. And because it might come up later, the highlight of this, and let me read it for you since you can't read this. The last paragraph that was highlighted is that the school, this is the program, the task, what he's setting out to do in his undergraduate thesis, the last paragraph of which is that the school, this is for a synagogue in suburban Newark, near where he lived at the time, that the school and social areas should be pleasant and intimate rather than institutional. It is the combining of those areas into a harmony and design that will determine the final character of the entire composition. In the discussion later, that may be tied to Colin Rowe, his mentor, that happened later. So these are some pictures of the model from that project. This doesn't look like the Eisenman that we know. In fact, it predated the Eisenman that we know. we get a section. We get rendered images with people in them, not something you often seen from an Eisenman project. And then the other schoolwork project that I wanted to talk about is a competition that was submitted as the master's thesis at Columbia for the Liverpool Cathedral competition. Out of 450 entrants, he came in eighth place, which he leveraged to get himself into Cambridge, and he can give more details about that if we want to know about it. Model photographs from the eye point of a human being, which also doesn't happen very often. Site plans, plans, sections. And then after his master's at Columbia, he went on to Cambridge, where he met Colin Rowe. They went on perhaps one of the last grand tours. This is a map of Italy, the places that they went, all over Italy. And we get a little bit of insight into that relationship of mentor and mentee, specifically with regards to Eisenman's doctoral thesis, The Formal Basis of Modern Architecture, through about 40 letters that we found that Colin Rowe had sent to Peter. This is just one of them. But it's useful because it gives a quick characterization of what the aims were or what they should have been in the doctoral thesis. That in the dissertation which follows, you are going to ignore the iconographical and very largely to ignore perceptual issues, that your subject of investigation is the logical consistency or the logical interaction of concepts, that this excludes problems of value introduced by iconographical discussion and problems of psychology introduced by the intrusion of perceptual values. So the thesis was focused on developing a formal language and finding it. So this is some of the preparatory drawings. These are some of the drawings from the thesis itself. It's very easy to find the entire copy of this. It was published in 2006. And then after Cambridge, he comes back to the United States. Teaches at Princeton for a while, establishes the Institute of Architecture and Urban Studies, does a project at the IAUS called the Harlem Plan, which is one of the more sort of specifically political projects that the IAUS undertook. I'll flip through these quickly, and they are available if we need to talk about them later. And at roughly the same time, he got into the houses that we all know him for. So we have house one. The point of showing these diagrams isn't to look at the diagrams, but to notice that these could be turned upside down. There's no ground. They're up in space, those sorts of things. It's completely a formal language. Same with house two. They get more and more complex. House four. House six, and I bring up house six. These diagrams you've seen before. These actually magically materialized right before the exhibition. Diagrams that we probably haven't seen before. And I'll take only a brief minute to mention this one on your right. It seems to have a ground plane in it, which none of the other house diagrams do. This is house 10. A project that's built into the side of a hill, but still manages to very loosely acknowledge the ground that's underneath it. Here in elevation, you have no idea where the ground is. It's known more for this model and this critique of vision and axonometrics. Here in house 11A and Conoreggio, I think we get some direct engagement with the ground. And huge time jump from here. This is 1978 to 1998, just because we have 58 seconds left in my time. We're here looking at Berlin, which is designed very much with the users in mind, and there's a lot more to that. to really understand Berlin properly, it's best to sort of zoom out and see it from up above, where you can see the top and this conceptual ground topography on top of it. This was made, we found this pretty interesting sort of construction document. It's simply an Excel spreadsheet. There's no space. These are not the stelae being drawn. It's just cells in a spreadsheet with the various heights of the stones and their relative locations. So I will end with the last find that we made in one of those boxes sitting around. This is a drawing that Mr. Eisenman made in 1942 at the age of 10. Caldwell versus Kearney are suburban cities around Newark, but also football teams. And Mr. Eisenman had made an official program for a football game that he was speculating would be done between them. So maybe I will leave it on that one and let everyone come up and talk. Thank you.
I don't know. I have to wait 1 second while I get the truth of the exhibition out of my head so I don't tell you what really happened. No money, no material. The 20 years that he leaves out is because all that material is in museum collections. And so Peter calls up and says, look, I have a chance to do an exhibit. I'm going to just tell 5 minutes of my story.
Bring the mic closer.
I don't. You do it. Peter calls and says, we have a chance to do an exhibition at the Venice Biennale again. And I just said, no. I hate that city. I hate the Venice Biennale. I don't ever want to go back to it again as long as I live. Plus, Alejandro Aravena is the commissioner, and his theme is going to be social activism should be the new project of architecture, which I don't think is a bad theme, but considering all the various Biennales that we've been in together before, and also that I've been in separately and he's been in separately, it seemed like a very good one to sit out. Because all it meant, and for those of you that have followed the exhibition and the fact that Christy Ballier from the school is in it, if you went there with any other agenda whatsoever, if you went there with a design agenda, if you went there with any other agenda, you were certain to be vilified by the press and by your
colleagues,
by a colleague of a certain kind, and that's exactly what happened. And so,
still happening.
And yeah, that's right. And in fact, it's happening right. This going to be happening tomorrow.
Right.
And so I thought this would just. Why do we want to do this? And so. He said, nah, you get it, you know, I just have to be there, so we have to put something up. So I said, okay, well, what kind of material do we have? And he said, you know, we have whatever we have around here we can use. And so that's it. So Matt and I, our choice was just go look every place. He said, look, and we didn't have an idea for the exhibition. What we had was, let's go look in the, all over the place, go look in the warehouse and in the office and just find whatever we can find. And whatever's interesting, we'll stick it on the wall as cheaply as we possibly can, and in such a way that I don't have to go over there. And then we'll call that the exhibition. Now, that's actually what happened, right? And so those big gaps of years that were in there have to do with the fact that most of his most interesting material has already been given or purchased by major institutions like the CCA in Canada or Metropolitan Museum. And so we were just hoping there'd be some scraps of stuff. And I knew that there had to be some stuff, like the letters from Colin Rowe. No one knew where they were. And I hoped to God we could find them. And we didn't even find them except by accident, totally by accident. We'd given up hope on finding them. And really had no idea until we put all this stuff together what we could do with it. And that's when this idea of that every practice, particularly every practice which was disputing the norms of professional practice, was also an effort to be an activist project. And in fact, in my view, a more powerful activist project, because if you're contesting the received norms of architecture, you're contesting the received patterns of existential life, which is far more important, I think, for architecture when you look at its history of what it's really been good at than figuring out how architecture might be able to participate in problems that it really doesn't have a very good history of ever having solved, like how does architecture build more cheaply? Now, I think that's a very good thing for humans to try to figure out. Humans should try to figure out how to build more cheaply, and they can do that in two ways. Get engineers and material specialists to figure out how to make building parts assemble better, and also get government officials to support low-cost housing. Architects then will take up the problem of using those materials and those opportunities to use what they do best, and that is make interesting living patterns that adjust more quickly and more with greater agility to the particulars of site, circumstance, and lifestyle. And so we became really interested in that. In the meantime, we discovered, to our surprise, that Peter was not the intellectual avant-gardist that we knew him to be. In fact, we discovered he became that kicking and screaming, and he did everything he could against his will not to become that. He didn't want to get a PhD. What he wanted to do was be in professional practice with his best friend from day one. He went to school, got out of school, immediately wanted to work, went to work, didn't like the work, went back to school, tried to get every step of the way. I'll let him tell the particulars of the story. He didn't want anything to do with the intellectual life of architecture, didn't know anything about the history of architecture, didn't know anything about the discourse of architecture. He just wanted to get out and build stuff and build it reasonably well. But one thing after another kept, and you see those in the synagogue of the church. And in fact, the brief for the synagogue is hilarious because everything you think he stands against, that's all he says. He's got four impossible sites to reconcile. Every project that you know Peter Eisenman for is to take irreconcilable context, the Wexner Center, the grid of the school versus the grid of the city, how you bring them together in a new unity or a new collage of unities. Everything you do, the project in Turkey, four irreconcilable sites all adjoining to each other in this particular context, and instead of picking one over the other or making something new, he brings them in together and gets them to work together with this incredibly complex calculus of formal manipulations. In this case, he simply declares that's not only impossible, it's undesirable. Only the atmosphere of unity and spirituality can bring these four neighborhoods that are irreconcilable together in this church. That's exactly what he says. But eventually, he finally has got 1 year left and he's going to go practice, and he doesn't go to England to study with Colin Rowe. Rather, he goes to France to study French Gothic architecture. That's going to be the last gasp of all the school before he goes back to practice. You know why this is going on is because you guys make a lot of trash. And I'm not talking about the Coca-Colas you drink and the popcorn you eat. Okay, sorry. No, let me finish. But when it gets down to the end of this, after all this stuff and all these discoveries, Matt and I find out we have these two things. And for you, in my closing comments, is then I get faced with a really difficult intellectual problem. One is, I don't think the best thing a theorist should ever do, in fact, I'm against it, is to discuss the biography of the artist or the architect as a good way to understand the work. Not only that, This is the architect I know best who's done his very best to erase the biography of any architect he's ever discussed, ever. So when he starts his career, he starts off with Taranyi, but will not discuss Taranyi. The thesis is about erasing the significance of the architectural intentions of the work and replacing it with a formal calculus. And so I'm faced with this dilemma that I've become enthralled with his biography, and it's giving me completely new insights into his work, even though I, as one of his proteges, and totally against a biographical approach to understanding the work. So that's problem number one. Problem number two is I'm also convinced that I and others of my colleagues have avoided the idea of the activism of theoretical architecture. We've done it in intellectual terms, philosophical terms. We have not really discussed it in political terms. And so we've opened the door to people like Aravena and others to claim the territory of genuine activism in the name and behalf of the population, when in fact that's the only thing that my colleagues and his colleagues, Tom Main and Wolf Cricks and Herzog and de Meuron, are really ever thinking about, and the work is always about. And so that's the end, that's how I end up after this exhibition. Peter?
First of all, it was somewhat like Jeff said and somewhat like Matt said. It's not as cool as Matt had it or as hot as Jeff has it. First of all, I wasn't against intellection. I didn't know what intellection was, so I couldn't have been against it. Jim Sterling, who sent me on my way, said, Eisenman, you're a terrific designer, but you don't know anything about architecture. And that sort of said, you better go find out something about architecture. I had no intention of teaching. I had no intention of doing anything, but here's where I end up. I think the interesting thing that has resulted, first of all, we have this book, the catalog of the show, that Matt and Jeff put together. And I believe that Jeff's essay, even though he would disclaim this, is probably one of the best essays he's ever written. And many people who have seen this essay feel the same way. It's a long essay, and of course, everybody feels that it should be continued. The point that he brings up, that Jeff brings up, which is the first time I think that he has articulated what it takes to have an architectural activism by other means. And why Jeff highlights my suburban, bourgeois, middle class, humanist condition. What did I want to do when I graduated from Cornell? I wanted to work with the best architect I knew. So the best architect was Walter Gropius, who was at hand. I went to work for Walter Gropius. And I realized that Walter Gropius was, you know, not what I had thought or what he had been set up to be. And so I was at a loss what to do, and I was lured back to graduate school, and the rest is a certain kind of history. But I know that most of my students also have the same aspiration because they come from the same kind of background that I did. We're all from the same kind of background, and we all want to be successful in certain terms. Now, the interesting thing that Jeff discovers in all of this is that an architectural activism is per se, and it's something he didn't say just now, against architecture as power. The power of image, the power of meaning, the power of being, let's say, in a community. It has been used by power in fascism in Italy, communism in Russia, Nazism in Germany, used architecture symbolically from the very first minute. And architecture is more subtly in terms of capitalism and Westernity has also been used. In fact, we all teach, the teachers here and ourselves here teach you how to make powerful architecture. And what is good architecture? Good architecture has good iconography, good symbolism, good meaning, good functionalism, good everything. Good. What Jeff has done is open up a really important condition that architecture is in as opposed to any other project. And that is that architecture, especially modern architecture as opposed to modern painting, had the project of in a sense, glorifying and iconizing modern construction. That is steel construction, reinforced concrete construction. It idealized construction. And this is something that Rosalind Krauss, in one of her very few essays on architecture, Death of the Hermeneutic Fandom, said the thing that she didn't like about architecture that was different than painting and different than sculpture and different than modern music was the iconography and the idealist iconography latent in supposedly good architecture. That this is the intent of the architecture is to idealize the social, political, and economic sphere of Western capital. And she said this was the hermeneutic phantom that haunted modern architecture and never had been talked about. So I think one of the things that Jeff has done, along with Matt, but Jeff in the writing and Matt in the sort of organizing of the exhibition, has done is to show the problem that we middle-class souls who want to be active face in going against the power structure. And it's very interesting because we have set a project for our studio this fall at the center of Yale's power structure. And the whole notion has been to see if we can come up with a project that does not glorify and beatify and symbolize power, but does the reverse. And of course, my new dean says it's going to be impossible. The president of the university says we don't want that. We don't want the possibility of doing that in the center of the institution. So it's very strange to say, how can you do architecture that's not supposedly good if the tradition of architecture as we know it is in fact to make these kinds of expressions. It's something that you can, for example, you can talk about Michelangelo, Palladio, Bramante, all of the Borromini, all of the heroes of the Renaissance, and you can look at them and say, you know, they were in a sense making apparent the goodness of Western humanism. But you can also look at them as outliers. And what's interesting is the modern histories that have been written since the 19th century have seen them as both heroes and outliers, but never has it ever been articulated that the problematic of architecture is its latent idealism. And I think what Jeff's essay does, and it's not about Peter Eisenman, it's not about my work, it's about his ideas, which I think are interesting, and it's I'm hoping at some point that he will continue to develop the thought because it is a radically new idea of the confrontation one has as a humanist activist against, as it were, the possibility of renouncing power. And humanist activism is a concretization of power. And that's what Jeff points out and uses me, rightly so, as a person struggling against this. And he says something, the most poignant line in Jeff's text is when he says, Peter discovered something by accident at Cambridge that he didn't know existed. And that was that there was a second power in architecture, a second activism, and that is the power of intellection. And I think that's true. And it was a discovery, again, an ad hoc discovery, but something that I think is very important to understand, that you can be a good designer all you want, but if you're not interested in subscribing to centralized power or official power, you have to be very careful how one uses meaning, symbolism, iconography. And of course, that the idea of close reading is one that we've talked about, Jeff and myself, a long time. The idea of close reading as a form of intellection that dams up the easy flow of communication is one of those possibilities. You are occupying a very unique building on the campus of this institution, which is devoted to power, by the way, the campus. This is a building that demands close reading. It's not like the Blackwell Hotel, done by my ex-partner and ex-roommate. It's a very different kind of building, very different than many buildings that one will see in all over the state of Ohio, all over the state of New Jersey, where I'm from. And the really important thing is to understand that this is against the established power structure that that Ohio and this institution are attempting to make. I think it's an important sort of cat that's been let out of the box. And I think it's really interesting to see, could you make a curriculum? I mean, can you imagine if I go to my client, the city of Istanbul, when I'm working on this museum and say, we are against this institution being a symbol of power. I'd be fired tomorrow. We are against making symbolic your buildings that supposedly are for the good of the society. And you know, it's a really tricky line. Painters don't face this line. Writers don't face this. They don't need a client. Composers of music don't face this. Architecture uniquely faces the need to have a client. One final thing, because you can say, well, you don't need to build. Manfredo Tafuri, another one of my mentors, before he died, said to me, you know, Peter, all of the ideas of intellection are fine and important. He said, but if you don't build, nobody will care about your ideas. And this is the conundrum that you all face. You can go out and have ideas, but if you don't build them, you don't exist. You know, Tafuri might have been wrong, might have been right, but it's at least something worth discussing. So. I always want to thank you guys for having a poor New Jersey boy come home, as it were. I never can understand why kids from New Jersey, great football players, come to Ohio when they could play in New Jersey.
Wait, do they?
They do. The two of the best players on Ohio State right now are from New Jersey.
Yeah, but there are no good football players that play in New Jersey, right?
Rob would dispute that. He went to Princeton. They used to have great teams. They had a Heisman Trophy guy.
Yeah, I know. That was like a whole century or two centuries ago.
So tell me, do you think it's fair what I've said about you?
No. I think it's flattering.
No, I wasn't trying to flatter you.
Lots of people have said that about architecture. I mean, I forgot about Rosalind's piece, and now I'm wondering if I just ripped her off and I got to go back and read it again. I don't know. Y'all have any questions?
No.
Matt.
mean, it can go on. Peter and I talk all the time. We talk all about this all the time, and we'll talk about this after this is over. So if we keep talking about it here.
No, but you guys ought to have, look.
Or Matt, Amita.
There should be questions. I mean, are you all being trained to serve power? Does it upset you to do that?
On the other side of that piece of paper is a drawing of a fake high school, which is drawn in American high school Gothic architecture, 10 years old. I always think it's incredible, for example, that the airplane is in perspective, just about to bomb the stadium. This is right.
It's not bombs.
This is right after Pearl Harbor. This is, you know. The whole thing is bizarre beyond belief. This was a program for fake football teams. This is a guy who had no friends. He would make up fake football programs.
Like I do today.
And he's out here to speak to you simply so he can go to this football game tomorrow. And watch the team that he was following as a 10-year-old get crushed yet again 50 years in a row. I mean, so, I mean, there's that biographical part of it. Thoughts?
Matt, well, I can say that working with these two gentlemen is different when the both of them are in the same room with you, and they're different when they are not in the room with each other. I think
is that right?
It is quite right.
I can't. That's hard to believe. I don't. Do you think that? I don't feel any different when you're in a room, do you?
I do. Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
You know, most of you know how Jeff can be disruptive. And many of you probably know how Peter can be disruptive, and if not, trust me, he can be quite disruptive. And when they're in the room together, they double that disruption, especially for, you know, productivity, like putting together an exhibition and getting things on the wall and getting it through customs and those sorts of things.
Yeah, I mean.
We got to get it back.
Yeah,
well, you have to get it back. I mean, let's understand something. He did this exhibition.
Right.
Every square inch of it. I mean, I was in New York 2 days. I looked through his stuff. This is great. What I want to know is why it's not in a different key when it's in the, when it should be higher when it's loaded and lower when it's empty by physics. But so that's one of the miracles of the modern world. The single tone trash truck. Then, you know, every one of you will at some point be in that situation. And so. Peter asked me, do I agree? I don't agree, for example, that architecture is in a unique situation that no other discipline is in. I believe that architecture, every discipline has a client. Every discipline has the same problem of trying to find out their relationship to instantiated power. And frankly, if you were to ask me, if you look at the 20th century, music and visual arts and the arts world has been more active and effective in its activism in moving political life than architecture has.
Jeffrey.
And so that's something I think is really interesting for me to continue to push forward. And yet, I don't think people realize how the when architecture is effective, it becomes background. So architecture has been incredibly effective in the 20th century, and for that reason, no one notices it. I mean, the outcry against contemporary and modern architecture, then get, you know, the outcry against the Guggenheim in New York, the outcry against the Wexner Center, the outcry against this building. And now, not only do people take those buildings for granted, they want them to be there, they feel comfortable in them, their subjectivity has been reconciled with them, they're reformed in relationship to them. Yes, they are. I know. Not the people.
Less is comfortable?
Exactly. Not the people that know that they are challenged and offended by them. Not the kings who know that that is there to make fun of them and to make them weaker. And they are weakened, but they're weakened not because everybody walks up to them and says, oh, look at what an idiot Les Wexner is. They're weakened because no one takes them as seriously, because they're there and they work precisely because they work insidiously. And, you know, whereas a revolutionary song, or if you go to the Wexner Center right now, there's an exhibition that's called Leap Before You Look. It's about a school called the Black Mountain College. I think the college must have been open 20 years, from mid-30s to the mid-60s, something like 50s. Every important artist of a revolutionary character, such as Robert Rauschenberg, studied with one of the great power painters named Joseph Albers, who was running the, wasn't he running the school? So Merce Cunningham, John Cage, I mean, this was the school of revolutionary thinking and of the power of all of the arts and performances arts. It's right up the street. I know all of you have been there, so when I ask for a show of hands so that the director sees how important this is, it will be just so obvious to her, I'm not even going to bother. But this is, so when you go up there and you see that work is now masterpieces. You won't go up there and say, oh my God, this is, you know, you'll see a black tar painting. Is there a black tar painting? Okay, so there's supposed to be an effort at a, so, you know, Robert Rauschenberg goes to his painting class. Joseph Albers is telling him what to do. He is so pissed off about it. He goes home at night, goes under the staircase of the school, puts black tar on a canvas because he's angry at his teacher. Becomes one of the most famous painting gesture. I mean, literally black tar that you would use on a road. He makes these incredibly smelly black tar paintings.
Needed a shrink.
Which are in Germany and you can't get them. So that's why this conversation at this moment with that show up there is just electrifying for the three of us. So that's why I don't quite disagree with him. I do think the contest is going on. I think everybody's involved in the contest. The fact that architecture even tries to make a dent in it. I mean, here's something I think. When you go to Berlin and you go to the memorial and you're inside the memorial and you don't realize that you're not seeing the memorial because you feel like the experience of the memorial, which is to always be in it, because architecture, you have to be in it to experience it. And then he shows the slide where you see the conceptual ground, which means you can't be in the architecture to get the architecture. That's one of the most radical ideas in the history of architecture, that the building itself only works when you're not in it, that you have to understand it and think about it and be away from it. It's fantastic. And there is a ground in Germany that no one can own and no one can walk on and no one can decide I can kick the Jews off of because no one can be. It's so politically charged that it'll take generations for, you know, I don't think anyone even knows it to this day, that the memorial is not walking through those stelae as if they were gigantic headstones.
I want to add two thoughts to what Jeff's just said. One of my first lessons in architecture was traveling with Colin Rowe, who's one of the important people of the 20th century, the late 20th century, and we came upon our first Palladian villa of a hot day in Italy, 90-degree day with high humidity. Colin went and sat down at a bar and had an aranciata, I guess, we weren't drinking. And he said, you go out there and stand out in the sun, look at that facade, and come back and tell me something that you can't see, okay, about the building. That's number one, which I think's really important. The truth about Les Wexner, he had never seen the building until the then president of Ohio State, Ed Jennings, my partner Richard Trott, and myself asked Les to come and look at the model. He came and looked at the model. He had never given a penny to Ohio State. He was always interested in Jewish charities. He, even though he had been a graduate and successful, he never ever had given a penny. He looked at this model and quickly said, Ed, how much do you need? And Ed said, 25. And he said, you got it. And which was 25 million, by the way. And because Ed had no money, to tell you the truth. And then Les looked at me and he said, you know why I'm giving this money to Ohio State? Which I didn't know why. And this is the telling line. He said, because people in Ohio are going to hate this building.
All right, now, I'm going to tell you.
That's a true. You weren't there.
I know, but I'm going to tell you two little end stories. I heard this story about Colin Rowe and Peter Eisenman, and I tell me something you can't see for a year and a half before I made my first trip overseas to Italy. Peter gives me a list of buildings, the buildings you must see, must go visit, and I've heard this story about stuff you can't see, and so I can't wait to get there and look at the architecture and see what I can't see. And I go to all these famous buildings by Palladio, the guy that wrote that what is painting thing you like so much. What's the guy's name? What is, you know, it with an A.
Alberti.
Alberti, that guy.
Alberti.
And I get to each building and I can't see a damn thing. You know, I'm right this far from Red and Torrey. There's a guy standing at Red and Torrey. And I'm saying, can you tell me where the famous Palladio church is? And he goes, right here. And I said, well, I must be doing good because I can't see it. You know. So there's can't see and can't see. You got to be trained to see what you can't see before you can't see it the right way. And I'm going to show you.
That's true.
And I'm going to show you a perfect example about this because I think this is the most exciting drawing in our show. Like this, when we ran across this drawing, blew my mind. I keep hoping one day that in midterm and final reviews at this school, this is all we're going to see. Because this is the drawing for the heights of the stelae. This is the conceptual drawing of the memorial for the murdered and missing Jews. And it perfectly captures everything about it. And so, this is the drawing where you cannot see, that shows you what you can't see perfectly as a drawing, and you shouldn't draw a perspective that for an architect, this is what he's talking about. And you gotta learn that, takes a lot to learn, and once you learn that, you don't wanna ever see anything else. You don't wanna go back and show him the perspective.
But there's a whole, Jeff, whole idea of architecture that you are talking about, that Matt, myself, Rob, that's fundamental to this school, is based on the fact that the physical phenomena are not the only condition with which architecture exists.
Okay. Now go back to that Colin Rowe place. Might as well bring Matt's whole lecture to life, because Colin says in that little highlighted paragraph, now he says right there, largely to ignore perceptual issues, that your subject of the investigation will be logical interaction of the concepts. So that's what you see. The only thing he didn't highlight, which is this next thing Colin wrote, which I suspect something of this sort might be useful. However, I think that I said something of this kind before. Now that's kind of what most teachers think. Every time they see you do something originally creative.
Right.
And like, you know, I think I said that before. So just, I want you to see what he left out.
So we realize that this panel discussion is a bit of a push. because we tried to present an exhibition which is really great when you see it in place, but probably quite difficult to give you in a series of
so buy the book.
Five songs. We're going to sell it Wexman.
Hold on, yeah, guys.
There it is. The only place in Ohio that you can get it.
Yeah. And get it signed by the authors and the
which
and
reduces the value of the book.
Phil, can you hold the book? Can you hold the book up? The book. We have many copies of it, but I don't say that to sell the book. What I say is that you've heard a little bit of the conversation up here today about the exhibition, and the book actually does do the exhibition justice. You really do get the idea of.
Ron, how much did you pay for those books?
I haven't paid anything for those
exactly.
books.
Exactly. So why do they have to buy them? Why don't you give them away as a lottery?
No. It's our very own Bernie Sanders. Yeah. I never realized.
Now, you talk about, here is me opposing power.
That's right. That's right.
Bernie Sanders wasn't opposing power.
Yeah.
Hold on, guys.
Right. So what you might have seen a little bit here is the discourse, or I hope that you have some sense of the ideas that are going on in the exhibition. So the whole idea of activism and intellectualism the importance of that in architecture, although it's different than what you might have thought of initially, is really important. So one of the things that I've always appreciated about Peter's work is the sort of anti-consumerist nature of it. And so That's what the exhibition is really about, and the book represents it well. There are only a few down here. We have more if people are interested in them. Jeff will pay $20 for anybody who wants one. So feel free to do that. I'm going to do that.
You got your thing at 3:30.
Yeah, you're gonna get them. What I would like to do is open it up to questions from the audience. Either you can yell and speak very loudly, or we have to pass the microphone up to you. So,
where are you staying?
We haven't talked about the fact that missing work has been contextualized as part of a post-1968 activist generation of novel thinkers and that level of activism in a way. And I think that a lot of the ideas that work is rooted in, such as the introduction of the grid and to a certain extent the French semiotics and ideas of signification, I think could be pertinent to the way that we're operating today. I mean, in that, let's say that Excel spreadsheet that is kind of a key signifier of the logic behind the program and the form, but also the fact that it is an abstraction of the organization and a way of just kind of understanding the relation of one cell to another could be seen as almost like a computational or data-oriented way of understanding the project. So I guess the question is really about methodology and how activism is. Do you think that activism is rooted in finding a specific methodology for pushing that activist agenda?
Well. First of all, I would never claim to have been on an activist forefront, number one. I might have been an outlier, but I wasn't an activist, I don't think. I've never felt that my work was against hierarchy, against establishment, for sure, in the way that I think some of the best architects in the 16th and 17th century, Piranesi, for example, or Rinaldi, or any number of Italian architects, we were part of a generation, Aldo Rossi, myself, Hans Hollein, etc., in different ways and in different ideas, against what one would think of as mainstream modernist architecture. But there was, at the same time, people like Jane Jacobs, who was an activist in the traditional outer vena sense of the word. There were people like Robert Venturi, who were postmodernists and against the abstraction of modernism. I think the only part of the work that I think you could say was activist was the linguistic work. I think the work, not necessarily with Derrida, but again, sort of against maybe Derrida's ideas, but to open that kind of thing up into architecture was a form of activism, and I think an interesting form. I think the work on grammar, for example, one of my critics said the difference between Michelangelo and Palladio is that Palladio was interested in grammar and Michelangelo in effect. The only Italian architect I don't teach is Michelangelo, because it's not about grammar or language, it's about effect. No matter how great Michelangelo was.
Bernini.
And I don't teach Bernini, but Bernini's a different kettle of fish. But so I don't want to take responsibility for something that isn't the case. But something I've always said, one last word. Frank Gehry and I have been quote unquote friends for a long time.
What do you mean quote unquote? Y'all are friends. That's not fair.
We're not friends?
You are friends.
We are
so
friends.
So you don't put it in quote.
We're quote friends, I think. Frank has an enormous amount of quote unquote work. I have. And what I wanted to say was, even though there are certain similarities in our behavior, being, background, all of that, clients can tell the difference between what I do and what Frank does. And I think that's really, for me, a very important mark. And I've never, even though I might have desired to be Frank.
So I would tell the story like this. They are friends. Frank has a lot of work. And they have quote unquote respect for each other.
We do have quote unquote respect for each other.
But let me, can I say something to this? Your question is interesting because for me and people a little bit older than that, not only does it say all the things you say about the digital world, which I actually hadn't really thought about, Excel spreadsheet did not come to my mind. What came to my mind was the record keeping of the Nazis. You know, so I saw that and I thought, wow, this is really powerful, because that also rings to that particular issue. And so what's important, and the reason I'm saying is I think that we need to keep two issues alive when we're thinking about activism. One is the critical project, and the other one is the projective project. And they've always been put into opposition. A projective project is, I know a better world, or I know a problem, and I can fix it, or we should make it. A critical project is, I see a set of problems, or I see a way of reading something and pointing out that there's something wrong with that. And we're not going to do the projective project anymore because it's generally too naive or too optimistic. We're going to focus on the critical project and keep destabilizing by showing, you know, the most famous example that easy to teach is, if I taught you, what was that Tom Hanks movie where he's a simple-minded, sports-loving figure?
whatever.
You know, it matters, because when you study that film, it's a very popular film, and he's a good guy, but if you look at the role of the woman, she breaks her role, she leaves town, she becomes an artist, she marches for peace, then she does drugs, gets AIDS, and dies.
Forrest Gump.
So if you're a good guy, play sports, really good guy, play sports, you know, go to war, support the right parties, you're going to succeed. If you're a woman, get out of your role, leave town, march, you're going to get AIDS and die. I mean, so that's a close reading of that film. And so instead of the critical project or the projective project, the point of the post-structuralist project was to keep work constantly destabilized and to make sure work was written with such with a commitment to a sufficient difficulty that it could never be consumed either way, as a critical project or a projective project. And I think that's where Peter's work was unique in architecture and remains unique in architecture, that it was neither projective, easily projective, or easily critical. And that phase is over, but we need to keep both of those projects alive so that nothing's, because architecture stabilizes so easily into one or the other. And so I think it was a very good question, but we can't use the last 20 years as the template for continuing to do that. You guys need to be aware of that, need to use the tools and facilities and means that you have at your advantage to rethink what it would mean to do a projective project, what it would mean to do a critical project, and what would mean to do a project that will not allow anything to be stabilized and be consumed. And I don't know how to do that, but that's where you need to be.
Another deep question.
I don't know how to do it either. It's a good point. Yeah, it's a good point. Today, it's hard to do.
Jeff, I had a question about when you said when architecture is effective, it becomes background. I wanted to ask for a clarification on how something that is background can be an effective activism tool.
It's the most effective activism tool. I mean, it's precisely when you're not paying attention to something and you take it for granted that it sets the stage of the customary. So the language that I can use, what I can say in public, you know, the fact that I can curse to some extent in my classes, although it goes and comes, depends on, you know what I mean? So I can say screw it now. In England, I would have gotten arrested in 1910 where I teach in class and I said, you know, you're a bloody fool. I would have gotten arrested. Now you hear it all the time. Television is about 15 years ahead of classrooms. So if I want to do something in my classroom to show certain diversity issues, I can't say it, but I can pull a television show in and show it. So it turns out, I've just recently learned, you know, so because television is a background, creates a background media, so I can say, look, watch this TV show, and they can say, oh, you can't say that, and I can say, oh, no, but it's a comedy. And so, and architecture is the background. I mean, I don't like going out in the woods because it's got sounds, you know. So I can't wait to get back to nature where there's electric lights and, you know. So you understand what I mean? The background actually sets the normal condition, and in that normal condition sets the standards for the what's received as relaxed or formal or informal. And that's why architecture. But let me tell you something. Bad is not the same thing as well-designed informal. You know, so that's not an excuse for bad architecture. That's a call to doing well-thought-out, informal, unconsumable architecture. And there's a place for architecture of very high attention, and there's also a place for a mid-ground architecture. You know, so it's. But that's why I think most of the people of the generation, my colleagues, focus more on that problem. His colleagues were much more on high attention, close attention architecture. Yep.
So just kind of jumping off of that, we also talked about how buildings like this one and the Wexner Center are like kind of go against those power structures. If it's good, it blends in. Is it against like a homogeneous banality of structure that we're able to appreciate things like this building and the Wexner Center? Or is it that they're just different from the like iconography of those power structures that we've come to associate with those architectural styles?
Well, this is the director of the Wexner Center. There's a lot of buildings on this campus that are different. There are some that are so different that after 5 years of seeing how different they are, I can't stand to look at them anymore. There are some that the different, like I don't find the Wexner Center different anymore. It stays unconsumed, but I know it really well. And so, you cut her off. You're the only one who has successfully cut her off.
Nice, Jeff. Thanks. Anyhow, I think that's a fantastic question, but the fact of the matter is, after essentially living in the Wexner Center for 23 years, I am still learning about this building and discovering stuff about it, and I doubt that there are very many other buildings on this campus, if any, perhaps even including this one, where that could be said.
And I think that's the answer. The answer is, if it's unusual and you keep going to it and its unusual features just stay the same and drive you crazy, like hearing the same joke over and over again, you just want to burn it down. If you keep going to it and it keeps rewarding you over and over and over again, it gets better and better and better.
I wanted to add one thing to that. I was at a poetry reading the other night, an Irish poet, and he said, I got to tell you all, the best book of the 20th century was Ulysses. And I thought, I read Finnegan's Wake, I haven't read Ulysses. And I looked up in the Modern Library, and the number one book, according to critics and writers of the 20th century, was Ulysses, okay? But the reason why I tell the story is the number one book of the Modern Library, and you guys are not gonna get this, but you should, by the readers was what?
Gravity's Rainbow.
No, there wasn't one Gravity's Rainbow on the list by the critics or the readers.
I mean, not the Reader's Choice in the 20th century.
Reader's Choice in the 20th century, the number one book in the Modern Library.
Candy.
The Fountainhead.
You're kidding.
I'm not kidding.
That just goes to show you.
What does it go to show you?
Don't look up the Modern Library.
I'd love to get to a question beyond the third row.
Seriously, amazing.
Candy was a funny answer. They don't even know what candy is.
No, they don't know what
candy
is.
Can you speak very loudly?
Yeah, can everyone hear me?
No.
Yeah. No.
No.
Louder.
There's 6 billion people that we have to say yes for when you say everyone.
So this might be a less deep question than the ones before, but I was reading an article about a month ago. I was actually reading an article. There was a man named David Driscoll, who was pretty much famous for being like a really good athlete, and he was at the Liz Berlin, and he was doing a handstand on one of the slabs, and he posted a picture of it, and there was massive outrage towards saying it was disrespectful towards the actual Jewish people.
That's nonsense.
And I was just wondering, you guys were talking about the power of architecture and the intent of design. Do you even have an opinion on that?
I do. Do you? Do you care that the guy did a handstand on one of the slabs?
No, I love it. No, that's what the slabs are for.
Kids playing there all the time. Actually, yeah. It's... Yeah, I that's just
No.
That's the problem with social media. That's the problem with people that it's so much easier to be cranky about something than right. say something nice. But it's just, why did you even bring that up? Jump! See how easy it is?
There's a question up there.
Where? Hey, he knows I didn't mean. You know I didn't mean to jump, right?
You better make sure.
Any more questions?
I guess that would have been bad.
Any more questions? Okay.
Wait, I need one more so everybody will forget that last one.
You should ask one.
What? Ask one.
No.
No.
What about the lottery? Ask about that. Lottery.
Anyway,
hey, I'm going to buy you a free book.
This is the book. They'll be down here signing them. There's a behind the screen is a reception. So please feel free to come and partake. Thank you very much. Thank you.